tell you that one of the cool things about the games for health field is how much more over time the industry is becoming interested in this. And not just from a purely business standpoint, but from the standpoint of developers and other people in the industry finding interest in the wider possibilities of games all over the place, but especially in health and healthcare. There are a number of, we've had a number of people here from places like Ubisoft and Konami, but also are a number of people who have worked in the industry in the past. And one of the gentlemen who's here, I'm going to introduce him, and he's going to have the pleasure to introduce our next keynote speaker. So I'd like to introduce George Rose. For those of you who might not know George, and I've only gotten to know him in the last year or so, George is general counsel for Activision for, I think, at least a couple of decades now, prior to your recent retirement. But more importantly to me, George is interesting because I met him through Adam Gazzoli, who spoke on Tuesday. Adam is a researcher out at University of California, San Francisco, and is also a health claims research grantee. And through George's Rose Family Foundation, he and Adam have stood up a conference called S-Cons, the first one of which was held about a year and a half ago, specifically looking at, very deeply at the intersections between games and cognitive science. So George is someone who spent a lifetime, at least my lifetime in the industry, but is now taking a real, real interest in all the work that you see going on in this space. And so I'd like him to come up and say a few words, and he'll have the pleasure to introduce our next keynote speaker. Please welcome George Rose.
Hi. I'll be really brief. I was asked to introduce Jane, and actually I haven't met Jane until today, even though I heard about her, read about her, and actually she's a good reason why I'm not at Activision anymore, because I got to see a lot of her lectures and on YouTube, and about 3 years ago our president, who's not known for being warm and fuzzy, asked me to look at what she has to say, and actually shocked me and made me very interested in what there is other than making $100 million worth of Call of Duty. But in any case, it's an interesting saying because there is a side to video games that we all know about where there's two or three companies that are making billions and billions and billions of dollars. And I've been part of that side for, as was mentioned, about 20 years, it could be 15, it could be 100 years. And as was mentioned earlier today, we're all growing up. I've been in that industry for all these years, and I now have children. I now, older than I was. And I'm beginning to think that there's more to it than just doing that. And there are many people similarly inclined as I am. And we're all coming out of that phase in our lives. And we're all beginning to think that there's a lot more to video games. We all understand what video games can do. We all understand what video games may do in the future. And we all understand what we can do with video games down the road. We understand that there's more to video games than just play. We understand that video games, the biggest component to it is interactivity and the ability to use it for a variety of different reasons. And so many of us, as we are beginning to get involved in things that are different than just making games for, lack of a better word, fun, we're beginning to look at different things, things like social impact, things like education, things like medicine. And all of these people who have spent decades building huge, enormous, complex environments are now getting together and looking for other things to apply our minds to. And not just our minds, but our resources. And whether it's been by direct investment or by work through foundations that we set up, or by simply finding out appropriate ways to apply our talents. I mean, it is happening. And we're finding out that our talents could be used for those kinds of purposes. And that's why I think it's important for you to understand that it is going to happen. I mean, people like myself, people like my colleagues are going to find our way to your part of the world, and we will find a way to make your lives probably easier and better. We'll find a way to make your games much more interesting and engaging. We'll find a way to make them commercialized. We'll find a way to get them to the public. We'll find a way to get them into the places where they have to go, and whether or not they're going to become more interesting for you, it's becoming to be an open question, but the fact is that we're looking for ways to, you know, spend whatever time is remaining for us to do something else. And that's why we want to find our ways in places like this and spend our time with you and find a way to do things that are very important. Now, speaking of Jane, I mean, after spending this time, and actually she was at Activision delivering a lecture, and from what I understand, being there, people actually got very interested and very excited about it. She is an extremely dynamic speaker. She has spent, you know, lifetime, you know, talking about different things about video games. I mean, there are many different things on the internet that you can read about her. Some of them are not necessarily, perhaps correctly, it's not going to cure the world the day after tomorrow, but maybe they will. You know, at least they will make you feel super better. She is one of the 100 creative people in business, according to Fast Company, and she is pals with Oprah, which I cannot say I am. And she is the chief creative officer of something known as SuperBetter Labs, which I think is a great name, and if it hasn't been trademarked, she should as soon as possible.
Good legal advice.
I think she needs not a lot of introduction. I think you have seen and heard about her enough. She is a graduate of Berkeley, and she is probably one of the most dynamic speakers in this area you can ever hear. I mean, if she can't hold your attention for longer than, you know, or at least for at least 2 hours, there's something wrong with you. But she certainly will, and you will enjoy the next hour that's allotted to you very, very much. So without much more ado, here's Jane.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming out so early for this. I'm really excited to be here. We're going to do a crash course in getting super better. Before I do that, I just wanted to say how happy I am to be here. In all honesty, Ben, who's going to be too busy to even stay in your room to hear this remark, I can't remember the last time I was at a conference where I felt like we were all in it together in the way that I feel here. Every single person I meet, I feel like we are on the same journey, and we are allies in this mission together. I can't remember being at a conference where I felt that about every single person I met and every single talk that I went to. So this is a special event. I'm really happy to be here. I'm also excited because I'm going to show you some data that nobody's seen before. We are debuting it here. We've been running SuperBetter's beta for 12 weeks now, and we've got some juicy data to share with you. But before we get to that data, I want to give you an insider tip for this talk. I'm going to show you a lot of science, or I'm going to really quickly refer to a lot of different studies. And I don't want you to have to worry about what was that study and what was she talking about. If you can just remember, show me the science, and go to showmethescience.com later, all of the papers that I mentioned, the full papers, so you can read them, the peer review papers, all of it is in a blog post in the order that I present this talk, so you can actually dig into the literature if you want. And the full slides of this talk are there too. So just remember, show me the science, and then you can just relax and enjoy the talk, and I'll take any notes, look at all the slides and the research later. Okay, so the most important thing to know about me that was not mentioned in that introduction is that I am a gamer, like many of you, and because I am a gamer, I like to have goals. I like special missions and secret objectives, so I actually have a special mission for this talk. And this is my special mission for this talk. Believe it or not, I'm going to try to increase the lifespan of everyone in this room by 7.5 minutes by the end of this talk. I mean that literally, you will live 7.5 minutes longer than you would have otherwise just because you watched this talk. Some of you are looking a little bit skeptical, but that's okay because I have math to prove this. This is the math. It won't make a lot of sense now. I'll explain it all later. The most important part is right at the bottom. That plus 7.6824583 minutes. That will be my gift to you if I succeed in my mission. Now, you guys have a special mission too. Your mission is to figure out what you want to do with those 7.5 minutes. And I think you should do something unusual with them because these are bonus minutes. You are not going to have them anyway. So don't spend them like texting or doing email. I will give you some ideas later of what I think you should do with them. But if you know anything about me or you've seen any of those talks, you might have some ideas already of what I would suggest you do with those 7.5 minutes. You're probably thinking to yourself that I would like you to spend them playing games, which is a reasonable assumption, given that I have made quite a habit of encouraging people to spend more time playing games. The most viewed talk I did was for Ted, and I did propose in that talk that we should spend 21 billion hours a week as a planet playing games. So 21 billion hours is a lot of time. It's so much time, in fact, that the number one comment, unsolicited, that I hear all the time from people all over the world these days, actually, is this: Jane, games are great and all, but on your deathbed, are you really going to wish you spent more time playing World of Warcraft? This is great aha that I get. Those more recently, people are asking me, on my deathbed, I will wish that I spent more time playing Angry Birds. But this idea is so ubiquitous that games are a waste of time that I literally hear this question everywhere I go. This is a true story. Just a few weeks ago, in a cab, this cab driver finds out that my colleague and I are in town for a game developers conference, and he turns around completely on his own and says, it's a direct quote, I took a picture to prove that it happened, I hate games, waste of life, imagine getting to the end of your life and regretting all that time. Now, I actually want to take this question seriously because I want games to be a force for good in the world, like everyone in this room. And I certainly don't want people, when they get to the end of their lives, to regret all the hours they spent gaming, hours that I encourage them to spend. So I've actually been thinking about this question a lot lately, and it might seem weird for a Games for Health conference to be talking about deathbeds, but just go with me here for a little bit. I've been thinking about, you know, when we are on our deathbed, will we regret all the hours we spent playing games? Now, this may surprise you, but it turns out there is actually some research on this question. It's true. You may have seen this in the headlines earlier this year. It's hospice workers, people who take care of us at the end of our lives, have actually issued a report on the most commonly expressed regrets by people when they are literally on their deathbeds. So that's what I want to share with you today, the actual top five regrets of the dying. This is number one. I wish I hadn't worked so hard. Number two, I wish I'd stayed in touch with my friends. Number three, I wish I'd let myself be happier. Number four, I wish I'd had the courage to express my true self. And number five, I wish I'd lived a life true to my dreams instead of what others expected. Now, as far as I know, no one told the hospice workers I wish I'd spent more time playing games. But when I hear those top five regrets of the dying, I can't help but hear, as many of you probably heard as well, five deep human cravings that we know that games can actually help us fulfill. For example, I wish I hadn't worked so hard. Well, for many people this means I wish I'd spent more time with my family, more time with my kids when they were growing up. when you know that playing games together has huge family benefits. You probably saw the research from Brigham Young University, School of Family Life, that recently showed that parents who frequently play video games with their kids have much stronger relationships with them in the rest of life. I wish I'd stayed in touch with my friends. Well, hundreds of millions of gamers use games like Farmville or Words with Friends to stay in daily contact with their real-life friends and family. And Michigan State University recently released research showing that these games are actually incredibly powerful relationship management tools. They help us stay actively in touch with people in our social network that we would otherwise grow distant from if we weren't playing games together. I wish I'd let myself be happier. And here I can't help but think of what I think is one of the top findings to come out of the field of games for health, the clinical trials conducted at East Carolina University with PopCap games, showing that online games actually outperform pharmaceuticals for treating clinical anxiety and depression in this particular clinical trial. They found that just 30 minutes of online gameplay a day was enough to significantly boost mood and have a lasting impact on the player's happiness. That is groundbreaking. I wish I had the courage to express my true self. Well, avatars in games, right, are a way to express our true selves, our most heroic, idealized vision of who we could be. You can see that this is a portrait from the Alter Ego series by photographer Robbie Cooper that I just love, of an avatar with its creator. And Stanford University, as many of you know, have been doing research for 5 years now showing that playing games with idealized avatars actually changes how we think about ourselves and act in real life. It makes us more courageous, more confident, and more ambitious in real life. I wish I'd led a life true to my dreams and not what others expected of me. Now this one I'm not sure about yet, so I've left a question mark here, a little Super Mario question mark. There's not as much evidence here yet, so I'm gonna come back to this one. So okay, at this point now you might be thinking, who is this game designer to really be philosophizing about deathbed regrets? It's true, I've never been a hospice worker, and I haven't been on my deathbed yet, come with it. But recently, I did spend 3 months in bed, wanting to die, actually, really wanting to die, and I kind of wanted to tell you that story. So it started when I hit my head, and I got a concussion, and the concussion didn't heal properly, and after 30 days, I was stuck with symptoms like nonstop headaches, vertigo, nausea, mental fog, memory loss. I couldn't work at all. I could barely read or write. I had a hard time explaining to friends and family what was going on because of the brain injury. Communication was hard. I mean, I could speak, but I just couldn't think clearly. So this is something I scribbled down at the time. Everything is hard. The iron fist is pushing against my thoughts. My whole brain feels vacuum pressurized. If I can't think, who am I? It took me more than an hour at the time to write that, and then I just kind of gave up for a really long time. Now, my doctor had told me that in order to get better, it was really important that I rest my brain, because I was having a problem not working and not being busy, and I kept stressing out the brain and was slowing down healing. So she gave me this whole list of things that I couldn't do because they were triggering my symptoms. No reading, no writing, no video games, no work email, no running, no alcohol, no caffeine. In other words, I think you see where this is going. No reason to live, which is totally meant to be funny, of course. But as many of you also know, suicidal ideation is actually quite common with traumatic brain injuries. It actually happens to 1 in 3, and it happened to me. My brain started telling me, Jane, you want to die. It said, you're never going to get better. It said, the pain will never end. And these voices were so persuasive and so persistent that I actually legitimately feared for my life. It was very strange. So like any good game designer, at that point, after 34 days, I said to myself, and I will never forget this moment, I am either going to kill myself, or I'm going to turn this into a game. Now, why a game? I don't have to tell you guys, but I knew from my 10 years of researching games, I knew from the scientific literature, the neuroscience of gaming, that when we play a good game, we tackle tough challenges with more determination, more creativity, more confidence and optimism, and we're more likely to reach out to others for help. So I wanted to bring those gamer traits to my real-life challenge, and I wound up inventing a role-playing recovery game called Jane the Concussion Slayer, inspired, obviously, by Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And adopting that secret identity meant that I was committed to fighting, no matter how scared I was. So the first thing I did as the Slayer was I called up my twin sister, Callie, and I told her, I'm starting to play a new game to heal my brain, and I want you to play the game with me. But that was actually an easier way to reach out and ask for help. Much easier to say, you know, I want you to play a game with me than to say, I'm really scared, I need your help. Now she became my first ally in the game. My husband joined next, so did some of our friends. And together we identified and battled bad guys. So these were anything that could trigger my symptoms and slow down the healing process. Things like fluorescent lights and crowded spaces. And they helped me activate and collect power-ups. This was anything I could do on even a really, really bad day to feel just a little bit productive or just a little bit happy. Things like cuddling my dog for 10 minutes or getting out of bed and walking around the block once, actually putting on my shoes and walking around the block. Now the game was that simple. Adopt a secret identity, recruit your allies, power up, and battle the bad guys. But even with such a simple game, within a few days of starting to play, that fog of depression and anxiety, it just lifted, it just went away. It was by no means a miracle cure for the headaches and cognitive symptoms. I mean, that lasted for more than a year. Definitely the hardest year of my life by far. But even while I still had the symptoms, and even while I was still in pain, I stopped suffering. Now, what was interesting was I had designed this game to help me get better, as in back to normal. I just wanted to be what I had been before I hit my head. But as I played the game, I didn't feel like I was just getting better. I felt like I was getting super better, like more than better, better than I had been before I hit my head. I felt like I had survived a trip to the underworld. You know, I'd been to like the worst possible place I could go, the most painful, the darkest, and somehow fought my way back, and that had made me stronger and braver. And you know, mythology, that's how heroes become heroes, right? You go to the underworld and you survive your trip. And then somehow that's what I felt like I had been through. So what happened next was interesting. I put this video online explaining how to play the game in a blog post, but because not everybody wants to be a slayer or not everybody has a concussion, I changed the name to SuperBetter, because that's how I felt at the time. And I started to hear from people all over the world who were getting super better, adopting their own secret identity, recruiting allies for things like chronic pain and cancer, for depression and anxiety, for Crohn's disease, and even for terminal diagnoses like ALS, hearing that people are getting super better with that. And what I could tell from the videos and the blog posts and the messages was that the game seemed to be helping these other players in the same ways that it helped me. They were talking about feeling stronger and braver. They talked about feeling better understood by your friends and family. And they talked about feeling happier, even while they were in pain, and even when they were struggling with the hardest challenge of their lives. And at the time, as I started to see all this, I mean, it was surprising even to me. If it hadn't already happened to me, I wouldn't have believed it was possible that a game this trivial, this silly, I mean, it is silly to become a superhero. It sounds ridiculous. How could something like that intervene so effectively in such serious, and in some cases, life and death circumstances? Well, it turns out there's some research here too. It turns out some people get stronger and happier after a traumatic experience. That's what seemed to be happening to all of us. We were experiencing what researchers call post-traumatic growth, which is not something we normally talk about. We normally talk about post-traumatic stress disorder, but researchers now know that a traumatic event doesn't doom us to suffer indefinitely. We can actually use it as a springboard to unleash our best qualities and to lead happier lives. So here, for example, are five of the top things that people who experience post-traumatic growth say. My priorities have changed. I'm not afraid to do what makes me happy. I feel closer to my friends and family. I understand myself better. I know who I really am now and what I'm really capable of. I have a new sense of meaning and purpose in my life. I'm better able to focus on my goals and dreams. Now, does this sound a little bit familiar? It should, because the top traits of post-traumatic growth are essentially the exact opposite of the top five regrets of the dying. This is pretty interesting to me. It seems like post-traumatic growth actually unlocks our ability to lead a life with fewer regrets. But how does it happen? I mean, how do you get from trauma to growth? Or better yet, is there a way to experience all these benefits of post-traumatic growth without having the trauma, without having to hit your head in the first place? Because that would be really cool. So I wanted to understand this phenomenon better. So I devoured the scientific literature, and I found out a few things. One thing I found out is that it may actually be possible to experience post-ecstatic growth, which would be the same as post-traumatic growth, except instead of having a trauma, you opt into a challenge that's really hard for you, like having a baby, becoming a parent, or running a marathon. And what's really cool is that today, the researcher who coined this term is actually here, Anne-Marie Ripke from UPenn. She's a doctoral candidate there, and she coined this term, which is how I learned about it, this idea that we could get the benefits without the trauma. But what is that process of getting to post-ecstatic growth? What is that process of getting to post-traumatic growth? What it really boils down to is really being willing to rise to the heroic occasion, being willing to tackle a challenge. And in order to tackle a challenge successfully, there are different kinds of resilience that we need. Emotional resilience, physical resilience, mental resilience, social resilience. And that there are actually scientifically backed ways that we can build up these different kinds of strengths. And I don't want to just tell you what these strengths are. I want to actually give you a firsthand experience of them. I want you to actually start building them up right now. So we're actually going to play a little SuperBetter together. If you happen to download that preview app, you can pull out your iPhones now and you can play it. If you didn't download the app, we're just going to play it together right here. So what we're going to do, this is how you earn those 7.5 minutes of extra life that I promised you, by the way, completing these 4 SuperBetter missions. So we're going to do these 4 missions together, and this is your first mission. I want you to pick one. Stand up and take 3 steps, or make your hands into fists, raise them over your head as high as you can for 5 seconds. Go! I like the people doing both. You're very overachiever. Very good. All right, excellent. That is worth +1 physical resilience in SuperBetter. Now, physical resilience means your body can withstand more stress and heal itself faster. And what we know from the research is that one of the best ways to increase your physical resilience is simply to not sit still. Every single second that you're not sitting still, you're actually actively improving the health of your heart, your lungs, and your brain. So good job not sitting still, and I think you should do that for all the rest of the talks or the rest of the conference. I don't think the other speakers will mind, just periodically. It'll be a little bit of cheering for me, I love it. Okay. So next question. Pick one. Snap your fingers exactly 50 times or count backwards from 100 by 7 like this, 193. You can do that in your head if you want. Go. Even one as absurd as snapping your fingers exactly 50 times or counting backwards from 100 by 7 is actually a scientifically backed method of increasing mental focus and boosting willpower. So, good job, everybody. Now we're focused for this much tougher quest. Pick one. Now this one, because fate has sort of put us in a room without any windows, it's kind of decided for you. But here are the 2 options. If you're inside, find a window and look out of it. If you're outside, find a window and look in. I encourage you to do that one later. Or do a quick YouTube or Google image search for baby, your favorite animal. Now you can pull out your phone and do this now. Also, feel free to just call out some animals, and I'm going to put some up on the screen. So what baby animals should we look at? Elephant?
Baby sloth.
Baby sloth, that would be good. Penguin would be good. Okay, let's see what fate wants us to look at. All right, we have a baby dolphin and baby llamas. Let's just feel that for a minute. Everybody look. Okay, has somebody yelled out baby elephant? There's a baby elephant. Okay, so cute. Okay, everybody feel that? Okay, good. So that's worth +1 emotional resilience, which means that you have the ability to provoke positive emotions whenever you need them. So curiosity, which you can provoke by looking in and out of windows, or love, which we know we can activate by looking at pictures of baby animals. Those are just two positive emotions that the research shows actually boost your creativity, your energy, your stamina every single time you feel them. And many of you probably know this trick. It's my favorite SuperBetter secret science sauce of all. If you can actually achieve a ratio of experiencing three positive emotions for every one negative emotion over the course of, you know, an hour, a day, a week, that actually dramatically improves your health, but also your ability to solve any problem that you're tackling. It's called the 3-to-1 ratio. It's my favorite SuperBetter trick. Here's a little extra science I don't normally share, but you guys are geeky, so I will. There's actually an upper limit to that ratio, which is 12-to-1. If you're experiencing more than 12 positive emotions for every one negative emotion, you lose the benefits because the people around you start to hate you. That is literally the science of literature. So don't go too far with it. All right, last quest. I want you to pick one. Shake someone's hand for 6 seconds or send someone a quick thank you by text, email, Facebook, or Twitter. Go. Showing that holding someone else's hand for 6 seconds is one of the most reliable ways to boost oxytocin in the bloodstream. So the love hormone, the trust hormone. You guys are all now, who shook hands, biochemically primed to want to help each other more. So this will last for the next hour. Take advantage of the networking opportunities. You can ask a favor for it. Make sure you do that. Okay, so those are the first four SuperBetter quests. Those are the first four things any player does on their phone or on the online game. So now you've all been through that. And I want to say to you, congratulations, because for the next 24 hours, you will have increased resilience. You should do something hard today, or you should stay up late, or you should reach out to someone interesting, or you should take a risk, because you're more likely to succeed, and if you fail, you'll bounce back faster because you're resilient. So this is really what we're thinking about with SuperBetter. We're thinking about building personal resilience, and we're tackling it from all these different angles, physical, mental, emotional, and social, because that's what the research shows it really takes to be able to succeed in the face of any challenge, whether it's something like an illness or injury that you didn't choose for yourself, or whether it is something positive and aspirational that you chose for yourself. This is the game that we built. You can see what it looks like. There's an online platform. This online platform has been running for 12 weeks now, beta. We have 35,000 registered players. And the mobile app is launching in about a week, the full app. You'll get your little preview that you downloaded. We'll update with a link for you to get the full app in about a week. And something that's been really great about this experience, so SuperBetter is a startup company now. It's not just me and my husband making stuff up as we went. Is we partner with a lot of great research groups and scientists, particularly UC Berkeley's Greater Good Science Center, the Stanford University C-Care Group, which is the Center for Compassion and Altruism Research and Education, as well as their School of Medicine, Penn's Psychology, Positive Psychology Center, and the Ohio State University Medical Research Center. And I know some of you are in this community, so I'll just share with you some of the folks because they'll be familiar to you. Dr. Keltner at UC Berkeley, Christine Carter at Berkeley, Jim Doty at Stanford. My twin sister, Kelly McGonigal, one of the first SuperBetter allies. Anne-Marie Rippey, who's here from UPenn, and Lee Swerden-Chowdhury from OSU, the Medical Research Center. And this has been great because we've been able to work with these researchers to make sure that we're building in evidence-based gameplay, right? That's a term that I believe we heard that, I think, yesterday. I'm trying to remember which talk. But I really like that phrase, evidence-based gameplay. And one of the questions that we're looking at with the research and trying to answer, to go back to those deathbed regrets for a minute, is, you know, why is this so hard? Why do so many of us get to the end of our lives feeling like we didn't do what we should have done. We didn't work less. We didn't reach out to friends more often. We didn't do the things that made us happy or express our true selves, and we didn't spend the time and effort to pursue our dreams. Why is that hard? Why is it universally hard? It's actually quite extraordinary to think about why we don't do these things and why it's so universal at the end of our lives that we regret it. And I'm interested in that because I think in the health world, we face a similar paradox or dilemma. Why don't we do the things that we know would help us achieve better health? If you talk to people, they say the health is their health and their family's health. It's the most important thing in the world to them. So why don't we do the things that we know will make us feel better? Why don't we work less and exercise more? Why don't we reach out to our friends more often because we know the benefits of social relationships? Why don't we do the things that make us happy because positive emotions have health benefits? Why aren't we more honest and open about expressing the health challenges that we're facing to the people in our lives? And why don't we spend the time and effort to pursue our health? This is what we're tackling on SuperBetter. We don't believe that it's easy to do these things. We don't believe that all you need is a little motivation. We actually believe that this is one of the hardest things in the world and that that it's universally hard and that we all struggle with this. So if I had to sort of sum up what we're learning and what we're trying to design out of, you know, what does it really require to move so that we do feel super better? It takes three things. The first is courage. We have to have the courage to tackle a challenge and possibly fail. Right? We have to have the courage to possibly try and fail. We need agency or the belief that we can do something that will actually have an impact, right? That our actions do matter, that the choices that we make matter. And we need time, right? We actually have to make the time to tackle these challenges or to take the actions, right? And games are great at cultivating these three things. Right? When we play games, we do get courage from the sense of competency and from the heroic narrative, right? It builds up our courage. And agency, I mean, games are great at building agency because games so vividly show us the impact of our actions on the world around us. And when it comes to time, games are really good at getting us to spend time, right? We spend 7 billion hours a week as a planet playing games. We spend 250 million minutes a day playing Angry Birds. The average Call of Duty player plays for 170 hours every year, which is the equivalent of a month of full-time work, right? So imagine if we all spent a month of full-time work working just on our health. Now, to help you remember these three design elements that we think are really important, I made you a handy internet meme acronym. This is the resilience cat. Cat stands for courage, agency, and time. Now note that this cat is engaged in a very dangerous activity and will probably fall. But cats have 9 lives, so just think of that. This is a resilient cat. I don't know if that's going to catch on as an image, but I'm making it. So what I want to do now is look at these three elements of courage, agency, time, and talk about how we're actually building them into SuperBetter, the game. So we can start with courage. So you played SuperBetter, you got a sense of the sort of onboarding experience. What happens after that is you tell us about a challenge that you're facing. It could be something like an injury or illness, or it could be a goal like losing weight or quitting smoking, reducing stress, having more energy. We even have a goal that's just being awesome, and you can play for that too. After you tell us your challenge, we recommend what we call a power pack to you. You can pick from 5 power packs. We have more than 30 now, I think. But we recommend 5 to you. And you can see here, this is our full power pack browser. Not so small, but we have everything from, you know, the full plate diet, if you've said that your challenge is losing weight, stress buster, if you want to reduce stress, fun days or make a great escape for people with chronic pain or traumatic injuries. And you pick a power pack and it fills your game with bad guys and power-ups and quests that are specifically designed to help you reach your challenge. And the reason why I think this builds courage is that we don't often know what the first step to take is, or if we know the first step, we're afraid we don't know the second step. So this gives you really concrete actions, and you can see how small these quests are, right? Something as simple as, you know, snapping your fingers 50 times, and we tell you that that actually helps. And we stagger the game so that you're doing increasingly complex quests. But we think this gives you courage because you always know that there's something to do next. You know, you're not on your own, not even thinking on your own. And we build competency and confidence as you go through. So giving you the power pack is one way we build courage. We also try to build courage with our resilience score. This is something we're working on. The science is certainly not validated yet here. One of the things that we're working on is a clinical trial with Ohio State University Medical Research Center to validate this. We want to make sure that we can actually measure increases to resilience. So you have a four-part score that does measure physical, mental, emotional, and social resilience. And doing things like connecting with your allies in the game will boost your social resilience, or doing quests that are physical in nature will boost your physical resilience. And we think this builds courage because as you see yourself making progress, it really does build that sense of confidence. Now, your resilience score can go down based on what you report to us. If you tell us that you're not feeling well today, you know, if you haven't reported any physical activity, you haven't connected with an ally, your resilience score can go down. And we actually implemented that because the early players were annoyed with us that their score never went down. They said, I'm not better and better every day. You have to be real with me. So now the score does go down, but it degrades rather than taking the points away. You just have to re-engage to get back up to your full level. So it's just a decay, but it goes right back. So we're trying to build courage that way. Now, when it comes to agency, I'm really inspired by some research that was actually presented here yesterday from Hope Lab, which is when I think about research in the space, it's really my gold standard. If you were lucky enough to see Ellen's talk yesterday, you saw a little bit of this, but I'll give you a recap if you weren't there. Hope Lab is really interested in self-efficacy. What creates change in gamers, long-term change in their health behaviors? Many of you know the Hope Lab game. I'm going to put this on mute because it might start playing. It's not that loud. This is the Hope Lab game Remission, which was designed for young people with cancer. And it teaches them about things like chemotherapy and it gives them this experience of battling cancer in this kind of cool, super empowered way. You may have seen the randomized controlled studies that they did showing that playing this game actually improved chemotherapy adherence. That players of this game actually not only reported that they were being more compliant and adhering better, but they actually had 20% higher levels of the chemotherapy in their blood that was tested. So the game actually had an impact on how they were treating their cancer. And psychologically, these players also reported higher rates of self-efficacy. They felt like they could actually take action to combat cancer, that they weren't passive, they weren't helpless, that they had an active role to play in winning that battle. So they got really interested in how a game could really, you know, make such a profound impact that playing the game for less than 2 hours changed how they would act 4 months later. So they did more research. They put some gamers in an fMRI machine at Stanford, and they looked at the neural activity while people were playing this game. And they found some pretty interesting stuff. This is a picture of two different people in the study. They did map the neural activity of people playing the game, which you see on the active side, and they mapped the activity of people just watching the game, not actively playing. They could see all the cool, you know, visuals and hear all the cool sound effects. And you can see it's quite a stark difference. So it's not the immersive media experience that seems to be driving the engagement. It's definitely the active gameplay. And when they looked at where the neural activity was happening, they found some hot spots in the caudate and thalamus, which is really that reward center, as well as the hippocampus, which is responsible for long-term memory and learning. So these players were learning something. They were learning and committing to memory something, but what was it? Well, it turned out that when the reward center was lighting up, it was happening at very interesting intervals. It wasn't happening the way some people think about games. People talk about game addiction. They often talk about gamers really getting addicted to the rewards, you know, wanting those points, wanting that leveling up, wanting that access. And then we somehow enjoy getting all this stuff and get addicted to, getting more, winning more. Well, the players weren't lighting up when they won, or when they were successful, or when they were getting stuff. They lit up in the moment after they took an action, while they were waiting to see, did that thing that I fired actually hit the target? They were activating the reward center after they took an action, before they saw the result of the action, in that moment of hoping for an impact, right? So what we can actually learn from this research is that the pleasure of gaming is in taking an action and looking for an impact and in building that sense of self-efficacy. And because the hippocampus is activated, we're committing that pleasure of self-efficacy to our long-term memory. I think it's some of the most, I think I'll go on record, I think this is the most important research that's come out of the field of games for health ever. I'm really excited about it because it shows that games do boost self-efficacy. And if there's one thing we need more of in the health world, it's people not feeling powerlessness, not feeling helpless, but feeling like they can take action. I like to think of it as switching from the pursuit of happiness to the happiness of pursuit. That what really lights us up is just trying something, taking an action, pursuing an outcome. And it doesn't even necessarily matter what the outcome is. Just that pursuit is enough to light us up. So I also think of this as kind of the brain of a super empowered, hopeful individual. That's a term we use a lot to talk about gamers. These are people who feel like they can actually take an action that will have a positive impact on their lives or the lives of others. So other things we do for agency, of course, are the power-ups. You can see here some of the power-ups that we give to you in your secret headquarters when you download a power pack. One of our single most popular power pack is called Lazy Exercise. It's for people who maybe feel like they can't commit to going to a gym, but they want to be more physically active. So, you know, a power-up like dance to your favorite song, you would see that. And then when you activate your power-ups, you get this great, you know, positive feedback, Shazam! And here's something that one of our players said about power-ups that really gets to the agency factor. What worked for me, going to SuperBetter when I felt like I needed help, finding things to do, new power-ups, and doing them. Even if it didn't change anything, it made me feel like I was actually doing something about it. It took away that sense of powerlessness. So, you know, when we hear things like that, we feel like we're on the right track. And we think that the bad guys contribute to our sense of agency too. That you can work up the courage to battle a bad guy, and you might actually make progress. We suggest bad guys to you. For example, we have a power pack called the Power to Quit Anything. So say you want to give up sugar, or you want to give up the internet on the weekends. We have a lot of bad guys, like doing it when bored, doing it when tired, doing it when hungry, doing it when nervous, doing it when stressed. Because one of the important things to do to quit a habit is notice the triggers. So all these triggers for you doing whatever you don't want to do, we identify them as bad guys. And the way that you beat this bad guy is noticing it and then stopping it from sort of taking over. We have other kinds of bad guys. For somebody with post-concussion syndrome, we have a power pack called Battle Royale, where they have to identify all the triggers and their symptoms and see which ones are still bothering them. Things like sensitivity to noise or sensitivity to light. And over time, you actually get to beat these bad guys. You'll see here that you can do these bad guy reports. Did you fail, did you win, or did you vanquish? Is this bad guy no longer a problem for you? You can claim ultimate victory and take it off your bad guy list. And then you tell us about how difficult it is. You know, is this not such a bad challenge, or it's one of the biggest challenges you're facing? And over time, every battle that you do boosts your resilience. We actually give you +1 mental resilience, even if you lost the battle, because we think it takes mental strength to be able to at least acknowledge and face the bad guy. So even if you lost the battle and ate the sugar or whatever you weren't supposed to do, you still boost your mental resilience. So here's something a player said about bad guys. For the first time, I was able to have an evening where I was very depressed, but able to know that it would get better. Able to get out of the all or nothing thinking. Just because you lost to a bad guy today, you could win against it tomorrow. So I think that's really important, thinking about agency, and not taking failure or loss as a sign that we don't have the ability to have a positive impact. And finally, on agency, epic wins are very important in our game. Epic wins are just aspirational goals that you set for yourself. We ask you, how will you know when you're super better? What will it feel like? What will you be able to do when you are super better? And I just want to share with you some of these epic wins. One thing that's cool is working at SuperBetter. Every time a player achieves an epic win, we get an alert. So literally every day, we get to hear about somebody doing something that previously seemed impossible to them, which is really nice. Some of them are really simple. They like to go for streaks. You know, how many days in a row can I do something? So here was a player losing weight, and their epic win was to eat right 7 days in a row. But we see things like, for reducing stress, they want to meditate 10 times by Friday. Someone who wants to sleep better, their epic win was to sleep without their iPod for an entire week. They were used to trying to use music to sleep. Someone with asthma wanted to go 6 days without using his inhaler. I actually want to read you, people can send us a note when they write, when they achieve their epic win, so I'll just read you his note, it's pretty interesting. When I wrote my epic win, I thought it was a long shot, but I accomplished it quicker than I thought was possible. 6 days, I've been free of the asthma pump. After 6 months of wheezing, coughing, and all kinds of medications, I'm breathing just fine on my own. Feel like I do have some power over my health after all. That's really interesting. Now, not because SuperBetter cured his asthma, obviously, but maybe because his player was slower to reach for the inhaler and just pay more attention to what was going on and see that he actually could control his breathing. This epic win for chronic headaches. This person just wanted to wake up one single day without a headache, and we see a lot of this, people wanting just one good day, one good night. They just want to see that it's possible for one day to not be in pain, and that's an epic win we see all the time. Here was someone with anxiety who just wanted to have one really good night. This player wrote us, "I didn't expect to see results this fast. I just decided to step out of my comfort zone and do something I was afraid of. And even though I was still scared while doing it, I didn't chicken out and I kept on persevering until the end. I also had an enjoyable time with my friends instead of becoming irritable and stressed out, except for 1 hour late at night. Praise the Lord." A player with depression wanted to not be bored for 24 hours. I thought that was a really interesting idea, a fun goal. I'm actually going to adopt that as a challenge for myself, too. Someone with back pain, I really like this one because it shows how epic wins can be different from sort of clinical diagnostics. This person with back pain wanted to go to the theater with her kids. She had so much back pain she couldn't sit in a chair for 2 hours at a time. And she wrote, "Yay, I went to a local theater production with my kids today. I drove, sat, and made it through the whole 2.5 hour day. I haven't been to a show in 2 years and it was wonderful. I've been practicing my driving, trying to increase my tolerance for sitting, learning to be mindful when I feel stressful, and it all paid off. Today, a local school show, soon I'll be seeing Broadway again." So you really see how these can build agency. And the last one, which is super interesting, the challenge was mood swings, and his epic one was to attend an intro to yoga class. So you can see how it's not always necessarily connected directly to the challenge, but things that they're trying to do that will make them feel better. So I want to show you a quick video of some people achieving their epic wins, just so you can even get a sense of it. Three players here, one playing for weight loss, one for sleeping better, and actually in the realm of the miraculous, she's here today. Would you mind raising your hand? If you want to talk to SuperBetter player, I was stunned. I would actually get to meet Deborah in person because her epic wins have really inspired me. And then the third player, Jeffrey, is playing for a terminal diagnosis of cancer. So I just want to sort of show you the range of how people are approaching their epic wins.
I set out to lose 10 pounds and go to the gym at least 3 times a week. And I blew past that 10 pounds in the first 5 weeks. And last time I weighed myself, I was almost at another 10 pounds. I lost another, how many did I lost now?
I started playing SuperBetter so that I could overcome my problems with sleeping. I haven't been sleeping more than an hour to 2 hours at a time a night for the past several years. When I started playing SuperBetter, my best night's sleep would be 3 hours. And that would only happen twice a year, and maybe 3 times. Well, so my goal was to sleep, my mini epic win would be to sleep 4 hours solid, 7 days in a row, and I did it. I did that.
I'm using SuperBetter to help with my liver cancer. I've had multiple myeloma, which is a type of blood cancer, since 2006. Since December 2010, I've been at NX for treatment, so my levels have slowly been rising higher, and I decided to become part of the SuperBetter project in order that I could use SuperBetter in order to maintain my levels at a sort of constant amount, as well as be active, so not every day thinking about what it's like to live with cancer. I chose the project of SuperBetter, where I would take a creative self-portrait each day. I chose and then uploaded it. I chose it through a project because I wanted to do something that would, one, force me to leave my place. Some days in here, leave my cancer. Some days just don't want to get up and won't. Because I found that I was each day focusing on ending the day on a positive note. I've been taking pictures during the magic hour in the evening, which is sort of the final hour before sunset. Before midnight, I would upload it to the SuperBetter site. And regardless of whether I went to bed afterwards or a few hours later, I still felt really positive in having this sense of accomplishment of doing something. This really helped me discover more about myself and learn and grow as a person. So to get back to this SuperBetter project and how it has helped me with my cancer, I found it being beneficial in that even though the cancer levels are high and that's a concern, I'm remaining positive and happy, and I am using this project to help maintain my health at a level that I'm happy with. I am not feeling depressed, I'm not feeling happy. I'm using SuperBetter to understand my world better and to, through that, understand myself.
This is the last self-portrait that most recently that Jeffrey uploaded just a couple days ago. It was really interesting. He was really excited. He's been off cancer treatment for quite a while now. He sort of reached the end of the treatment that's available to him. And he went to the doctor and found out that his cancer levels are 35.9 right now, which is quite high. But 3 months ago, he'd been at 40.1. He was excited. He was happy. Now, by no means does this mean in any way that SuperBetter lowered his cancer levels. He, of course, wrote a blog post saying that he really felt like SuperBetter had been a big part of this. But what I think we can say is that he probably wouldn't have gone to see the doctor to even know what his cancer levels were if he hadn't been playing SuperBetter. Because he talked about being disengaged and giving up. I mean, he has ended treatment. And to even see him so actively engaged with his health and still going to the doctor and being willing to hear what his cancer levels are, I think we can say that SuperBetter, the reason he knows that number and the reason that he's still engaged is SuperBetter, which is exciting. So the last bit is about time. What do we do to help you spend more time on your health and the things that matter to you? Well, we have a simple to-do list. We don't want you to spend all day playing. We just want you to activate 3 power-ups, battle 1 bad guy, and complete whatever quest you have assigned for the day. And when you're done, we say, ta-da, that's it, go home, stop playing. We don't try to take up a lot of your time. One player said, I've played SuperBetter every day for 3 weeks now. The main thing for me is playing SuperBetter means I'm making sure I spend at least 15 minutes a day taking care of myself. So we're just really trying to carve out a little space in your life that you will be able to spend every day. Allies are another way that we help you spend more time because of the social accountability. So you can invite real life friends and family into your game. You can also meet people through SuperBetter who can become your ally. Maybe people have been playing for a while, they can kind of mentor you. You can kind of see here, we cue you with questions about who might be a good ally, like who do you admire and would love as a coach or mentor? Who can you really ask for help if you need it? Who do you feel like you can be yourself around? Who do you like to talk to? And then you report check-ins to boost your social resilience. Here's what some players say about allies. SuperBetter allows you to spend time beyond therapy, 1 hour a week. You can play it anytime and anywhere. It helps you work on problems whenever they happen. Helps you involve your friends. You can't do that with therapy. I thought that was interesting. The idea of bringing your friends to therapy with you is totally weird, but you can invite them to play SuperBetter with you. Another player said, SuperBetter added a level of accountability I haven't had before. I'm accountable to my allies now, so they know they have to check in. They know they have to do what they said they would do because their friends care. Another player said, we talk in SuperBetterese. That could have been an epic win. You should add that as a power-up. It's become part integrated into our vocabulary, so I think it makes it easier to talk with people about what matters with you. We can talk about stuff more because now I have words to put to goals that he has. Another player said, my sister saw my success because she was my ally. Now she has her own site. So we are seeing that SuperBetter is contagious, that a player will play with you and then as your ally and then go on to set their own SuperBetter goal, which is cool. So now we get to the juicy data. What can we tell you about who is playing and how it's going? who's getting super better? So out of our 35,000 so far, we're looking at 55% female and 45% male. The average age is 33, which is very close to the average age of a gamer. You can see the distribution here. 21% are 18 to 25, 31% are 26 to 35, all the way up, even 11% are 56 or older. So it does seem to be reaching a broad demographic. We know that people are coming to us after struggling for years. So 40% tell us that they've been struggling with the challenge for over 5 years. The challenge that they're playing the game for, 40% have been struggling for more than 5 years, and 70% have been struggling with the challenge for at least a year. So we know that there's a real need for this. In fact, more than one third of the players say they're playing for the most important challenge in their life, that this game is helping them tackle the single most important challenge in their life. These are the top player challenges, which might be hard to see. You can see a huge emphasis on losing weight and getting fit and working out, as well as lowering stress, depression, learning to meditate, sleeping better. But what we found is a slightly different distribution for players who are really engaged, who've signed in 7 times in a row. We see double the number of players for depression and anxiety that you would expect for the distribution, which is really interesting. So one of our preliminary findings is that this game might be particularly sticky for people with depression and anxiety, which is really interesting because depression typically has low rates of return engagement. Because you're depressed and you don't come back. So we're really interested in that. Now, what makes the game super better? What are players responding to? Players tell us what they really like or love. Power-ups are everybody's favorite, followed by bad guys, and then power packs and epic wins. So that was interesting to us to see what was really important to our players. Kind of skip that one. I did want to just share with you a couple more stories from players. Showing you really how they use this courage, agency, and time. And I just want you to listen for the courage, for the agency, and the commitment to time in these last two videos. And then I'm going to tell you one more secret, and then we're going to be done. So let's watch these. Oh, actually, I think that video is in. I think this video is in.
So I retired in June of 2011. And I thought, how am I going to make the most of the rest of my life? I married the man of my dreams about 2.5 years ago, and now I could do anything that I wanted with the rest of my life. But I realized, first of all, I had to be physically fit. So in order for me to be physically fit, I had to go to the health club at least 4 times a week. That was my first goal. Also, I wanted to continue my writing, and I had 2 short stories to finish. So those were my first challenges, and I started working with SuperBetter. The first couple of weeks, it wasn't so easy. I wasn't going to the golf club 4 times a week. I really didn't feel like writing, but then I got into the swing of it, and I realized that if I wrote down and told SuperBetter as part of my goals that I was going to go to the health club 4 times a week, I could do it. So I did it. And sometimes if I got discouraged, part of the game are these things called power-ups. So I go after the game and I look for power-ups, and one of them is walk around the block or dance to your favorite music or do something that you don't usually do with your usual tasks, like use your non-dominant hand and brush your teeth or something like that. And I would do those things and it would make me feel better. The other thing, and I think the thing that was really miraculous for me, was the bad guys. Now, I sit down to write, and I think, I don't really feel like writing. Or, who would be interested in what you have to say? And I would think, no one. So I had this undifferentiated feeling that I just wasn't going to be able to accomplish my goal. But the notion of the bad guys is, you put them up, you break them up one by one by one. And if I took them on one by one, I could wrestle each one to the ground. It's like, it is a whole orchestra blaring these thoughts at you. What can you do? And if you have one cello player, bam! So, okay, here I am. I feel more fit. My husband tells me I'm a little more toned. Well, how could anything be better than that? I finished the 2 stories, and I am going to continue to play, and I hope that I can help others play, and it's been great. It's been fun. So that's what I have to tell you all. Super Better, thank you. Mwah.
I love her. Charlie, because Charlie represents, I mean, she's not a typical gamer, maybe, more typical.
My name is Charlie. I am from Atlanta, and I'm 29 going on 30. I am definitely a self-described gamer. My challenge during this entire journey of SuperBetter was to combat depression and anxiety. This is definitely something that has been affecting me for longer than I want to admit, but it is definitely something that's in my life every single day. The anxiety kind of makes confidence a huge issue, so I decided to give that a shot with SuperBetter. The game of SuperBetter, I don't really consider SuperBetter a game. I think of it as a real-world trainer that basically pumps up your character, or in this case myself, it gives me advantages when I face challenges in the real world. The power-up I use the most definitely has to be singing out my lungs. I cannot sing in public, but gosh darn it, when I'm in the car or at my house and there's a good song on, I will be belting my lungs out. Let me tell you, the endorphins released from that is amazing, and it puts me in a much better place. My favorite quest along this journey, one of my allies created this quest for me. It's basically turn a no into a strong yes. And basically, when you're asked to do something, even if you're beyond freaked out or there's no way that I should normally do it, as long as it's safe, go ahead and actually say, okay, I'll do it. So I utilize that quest all the time. The biggest change for me definitely has to be, energy. Sometimes, depending on if I'm actually accomplishing my quests, if I'm actually making strides towards that epic win, my energy goes through the roof because I'm riding a high. But then there's also those times that it definitely dips severely, and those are the days that just really suck. And that's what power-ups are for. This is definitely a longer battle than the amount of time I've spent on SuperBetter, because I've been battling this before and now that I think I kind of am taking the first step to being truly SuperBetter, simply because I'm outlining exactly what needs to be done. One thing I have learned about SuperBetter is that once you accomplish your epic win, you are SuperBetter, but you're not SuperBetter at the same time. There's still room to improve.
Cool. So I just like giving voice to the players. I want to end by getting back to that question that I promised I would get back to, which is, our games helping us lead a life true to our dreams and not what others expected of us. I think when I see these players, I think that they are. Some of the players, like me, have to survive this trip, the trip to the underworld. But other players are just kind of choosing their own adventure, right? It's more like that. But either way, people are rising to the heroic occasion in their own lives to lead the lives that really matter to them. So, I promised you 7 Happiness of Life. Did I do it? Well, here's the last little bit of science. It turns out that people who regularly activate these 4 kinds of strengths, physical, social, mental, and emotional, actually live 10 years longer than everyone else. There are literally more than 1,000 peer-reviewed studies documenting this. So, if you are regularly achieving the 3-to-1 positive emotion ratio, if you are never sitting still for more than an hour at a time, if you are reaching out to one person you care about every single day, and if you're tackling tiny challenges and accomplishing goals to boost your willpower, you should live, statistically speaking, 10 years longer than everybody else. So, average life expectancy, 78.1 years. This is that math, I promise you. The science shows you can live 10 years longer if you're living with resilience. So every year that you're living with resilience and trying to get super better adds 0.128 more years to your life, or 46 more days to your life, or 67,290 more minutes to your life, which means every day that you are boosting these 4 types of resilience, you're actually getting 184 extra minutes, or every hour that you're boosting these four types of resilience, like we just spent the last hour doing together, you are actually increasing your lifespan by 7.6824583 minutes. So those 7.5 minutes are all yours. Congratulations. That's your special mission. You still have to decide what you should do with these minutes. And here's my suggestion. I think these minutes are kind of like genie's wishes. You can use your first genie's wish to wish for a million more wishes. So if you spend these 7.5 minutes today doing something that makes you happy, or connects you with someone you care about, or gets you physically active, or helps you focus on a goal that really matters to you, you will be boosting your resilience. So you will actually be earning more minutes during those 7.5 minutes. And you can actually go on that way. This is the good news. Earning another 7.5 minutes every hour of your life for the rest of your life, all the way to your deathbed, which will now be 10 years later than it would have on average. And when you get there, more than likely, you won't have any of those top 5 regrets, because you will have found the strength to live a life truer to your dreams, even if you spend a lot of time playing video games. Thank you.
Jane has an appointment to go to right after this, but she gave me a stack of her business cards. You'll be around later at the resilience panel that starts at 11:30 in Ballroom B.
Yes.
The hashtag for the conference, if you don't know it, is #GFH12. ARA, if you've been wondering, they've been building an actual game over the last 2 days outside of the foyer. And it is now, I am told, complete and will also be playable on the web. So you might want to check that out as you leave. And then if you haven't had a chance to see today's Boston Globe, front page of the business section, our Exer Gaming tent, Blue Marbles game, and coverage of the conference. So thank you.